Hey guys, so with the world opening up, we thought we would take it outdoors and just have a meet and greet with one of the familiar faces, of course, of the Front Runner family, and that is none other than Greg Etafia, who's here to join me to chat about the loneliest position on the football field. It's none other than being a goalkeeper, something he obviously knows very well. So, Greg, thank you so much. We haven't had this one-on-one. Yeah. Usually I'm there as the referee trying to separate you and the other guys. But this time it's me and you just to kind of get a sense of where it all began. You know, I think sometimes anyone who's new to the Front Runner platform wants to know who are these guys that comes and speaks to every week. What are their credentials? And so I think a profile is fitting going into the new season. So let's start at the beginning, the football bug. Where were you? How old were you when it all began?
Yeah, you know, basically, first of all, you know, good afternoon, Kabza. Thank you for hosting me. I was born and brought up in Nigeria, in the northern part in Nigeria. So basically that side precisely is where most of the soccer players, in terms of the likes of Omokachi, Gariba Lawal, Tijani Babangida, Celestin Babanyaru, Emmanuel Babanyaru. There are a lot of good players that came out from that part, you know, which is Kaduna. Yeah, and they know them with politics, you know. Okay. So, yeah. But football is one escape route for everyone in that city.
Yeah.
So we look up to the likes of the Celestin, the Amokachi, you know. Yeah. So I started, you know, when everyone basically started when you're young.
Yeah.
Playing on the streets, you know, like you don't take it as a hobby. You just try to just enjoy yourself.
Right.
You know, I started taking football seriously when I was 14 years old.
Okay.
You know, I was playing infield and you know
which position
you know, you never choose position at that time, but everyone that be a goalkeeper right now want to be a striker,
right? So you started at the opposite end of the field and you ended up at the back.
You know, so the goalkeeper didn't show up, you know. It was a crucial game. You know, goalkeeper didn't show up, so hey, and everyone look around and say, you go to the goals and let's see how you do, you know. So I went to the goals and you know, those days, you know, you strike with penalties.
Yeah.
So we play, it was a 0-0. Uh-huh. Went into penalties and I kept 3 out, you know. So from then on, you know, hey, they say, you know, you are good on goalkeeping, you can try it on. The next game, which, I mean, it takes 2 weeks before, because normally you play like straight by straight.
Right.
You know, you get the straight playing the other straight.
Right.
So, yeah, we play again and I feel good. You know, I do play with my feet, you know, because you just enjoy yourself. You don't have that, you know, basic of goalkeeping in terms of how you dive. You just do generally enjoy yourself there.
So you're mixing up playing with your feet and catching what you
Could. Okay. So they feel like, you know, I'm doing well. So, yeah, I went home. My elder brother, you know, said that, you know, basically, you are left foot, and most of the left footed, sorry to say, they're all lazy, you know, apart from Messi. So, you know, so you get the skillful ones, you get the lazy ones. Me, I couldn't, you know, running wasn't my greatest strength, you know. So I just feel like, okay, stay on the goals, it could be better for me because I just use my hand and communicate. So that's how I started my goalkeeping career, you know.
Let's reverse a little bit, because obviously, between when you started playing and all these things that happened, you were going from being an outfield player to being a goalkeeper.
Yeah.
What are some of the things that you had to then get better at? You know, because obviously being outfield is a different skill set to being in goal. What are the things that your coaches focused on to help you become a better goalkeeper?
Yeah, you know, during those times, you know, you didn't have that, what we have in the modern day now, like a goalkeeper play with his feet,
right?
In terms of you playing from the back and all those things. You're basically, your main point was you to save the ball.
Okay.
And you still save the ball.
Right.
Don't let the ball goes in the goal. So I was trying, you know, to become a proper goalkeeper in terms of my diving skills.
Okay.
Because I was diving forward that time. So we didn't have a goalkeeper coach. You just have someone that plays the ball, you know, hit the ball for you. You have an outfield player. They just hit. That's basically the warm-up.
Yeah.
So, but when you watch in game in TV and you see the way they do it, so you try to enlist them when you come and you say, okay, can you please play it like this for me so I can dive properly? Because growing up that time was very difficult. There were a lot of teams that can afford goalkeeper coach.
Okay.
So it was basically infield player, the one that is not in the starting lineup. You just call him, you can cross this way, you can shoot for me this way. Because in West Africa, they didn't focus too much on how you play on your with your feet or whatever you do. If you can communicate and just keep the ball not to go in and catch the ball.
Yeah.
They feel you're a good goalkeeper.
Okay, okay. So once then you started getting to places where there was a bit more infrastructure in terms of coaches.
Yeah.
When was that? When did you start being exposed to proper goalkeeping coaches and structures?
That was when I went to Lobistas
okay.
and to the national team under 17.
Right.
So, yeah. So during that time at Lobistas, because it was it's like a premiership, you know, so one of the big teams in Nigeria, in Makurdi, is in the middle bit in Nigeria there.
Okay.
So, yeah. So I have Emmanuel Kala. Emmanuel Kala is one of the legends that played for Nigeria in the 80s.
Right.
Yeah, so he was the one, he was in the 17 national team with us, and we are camping in Makurdi there. That's when Lobistas, you know, when Lobistas signed me, they spoke to NUB. So he was the one helping me out there. But during their days, they too, they were just basically keeping the ball, not to go into the goals. Mm. And so we struggle. I struggle a lot with crosses. I struggle a lot to play from the back because basically during that time, they don't want you to build. They just want you to root, you know, hit, to root get the ball in your hand, put the ball forward.
Sure.
Your job is to save the ball out of the goals.
Okay, and then, I mean, obviously that means that you've clearly seen goalkeeping evolve in your career. You know, what are some of the trends? Because I'm guessing, like in any profession, you need to learn about all the new things that are happening.
Yeah.
When did you start getting exposed to those new ideas? And what are some of the ideas that maybe once you arrived in South Africa already, you had to maybe unlearn certain habits or things you had to develop once arriving here from Nigeria?
Yeah, there's a lot of things, you know. First, and which was very important for me, was the discipline, you know. Mm. You know, back home then you can go to training whenever you like, you know. Training starts maybe, just for example, training start by 4.
Yeah.
You can be there 4:30, you can be there 4:45, which is not acceptable
when
unprofessional. So those things make you to become, you know, to take your job seriously. Before we just playing it like we feel like, you know, getting money from it. But when I went to the Olympics, you know, see a lot of players that you're watching on TV, because that basically that time in Nigeria, you only watch the Premiership, you know, the EPL, you know, so that's where focus we can see once in a while every Saturday.
Yes.
Because it's not like now when, you know, they show
it every week.
So now I went to the national team and most of the players are invited to the camp, the likes of Julius Agawa, Yakuba Yegbeni, Celestin Babayero, and a lot of them that play overseas, now they start, you know, telling us that this is how, you know, it's done there.
Yes,
so
yes.
If you want to take it, you know, seriously, if you want to go
focus on these things.
So that's where I feel like, okay, now I have the talent, because everyone say to you that you have the talent, and it's not one or two people. A lot of people telling you that you can do this as a goalkeeper, you can get something out of it. I think, you know, from there, I just feel like, okay, this time I need to learn more things off the field, because basically I was having the skills and having that, the confidence to be a goalkeeper.
Yeah.
But off the field, you know, it was a little bit just late coming, you know, how to discipline yourself, the food you eat, and every stuff, you know, around, you know, intense, what's going to affect you on the pitch. So I was watching how I eat, you know, how I go out, you know, not late, you know, all those things, nightclubs and all those things. I tried to be professional.
Right.
Up the field,
yes,
discipline enough so that when I go into the field, I know that I can do my job properly.
There we go. So now you got into a place where you were mentioning names, right, in terms of the, some of the big influential players that would come and tell you guys what to do. Since we're naming names, who was the name that was involved in getting you from Nigeria to South Africa? When you think about your big break, who are some of the people that were crucial to you starting that chapter?
For me, it's a lot of people to give thanks to. You know, Emmanuel Babayero. He was my mentor, the elder brother of Celestin Babayero, because I grew under him, and watching them play in the Atlanta 96 was a big inspiration for every kid in Nigeria, and most especially me as a goalkeeper.
Yeah.
You know, he was, him and Dosu Joseph were the two goalkeepers in Atlanta that time, 96, and winning that Olympics, I feel like, you know, he inspired me a lot, you know, and when he came back, he gave me a jersey and started training me to be more professional. I was in Lobistas, so whenever I go back in Kaduna for holidays, so he trained me, and he was playing for Plateau United that time. It was a big side too, you know. So, yeah, and he went for trials in Belgium, in Standard Liège that time in Belgium. So there's a lot of things he brought to me, inspired me a lot. So during that time when I was in Olympics, South Africa were there too, you know, fortunately, because it's like a village.
Yes.
In 2000, South Africa played Brazil. I think South Africa played Brazil a day before we played, because we were playing against Australia. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so we won 2-1, and South Africa beat Brazil 4-0. So I think Gavin, in that time, he was at Black Leopard in Toyando there. So he saw the game, and they were watching the game normally, everyone. So, and he said, how can he get me? So he spoke to this one, Lawrence Opara. He was here. He was like an agent here. Yes. So he said, if he can find me in Nigeria, because it was difficult at that time. There was no cell phone. There was no, you know, not everyone
has it.
No one don't have opportunity. So you have to, you know, go to a center, like a phone center, where you're going to pick. That you tell, okay, I'm going to expect a call. You give a number, and you expect a call. So time, please, you have to come there and wait.
Someone gets
a call. So, yeah, Gavin called and say I can come to try us. That's how I came, and yeah.
The rest is history.
The rest is history. But yeah, it was a good break for me, for coming from Emmanuel Barbero and Lawrence Opara through Gavin, who was the coach at Black Leopard. I knew he was going to Swallows that time.
Okay, now, I mean, you guys export a lot of goalkeepers, Nigeria. Mm. What do you think that's down to? I mean, is it a genetics thing? Is it a... Because you speak rather, you know, strangely that there was no support for goalkeepers back in the day. You had to learn with the outfield players. There were no dedicated coaches.
Yeah.
How do you go from that to being one of the best... manufacturers of goalkeepers on the African continent?
I think before our time, there were the likes of Vincent Teyama, Delia Inigba, Ike Shirumu, Aloy Agu, Wilfred Agbonibare, and Emmanuel Babayara, I mentioned now. So they played overseas, you know, and their teams were not shown enough in terms of, we don't see them on TV, you know, like the EPL, because Nigeria, they base all, if you're playing EPL,
that's where
they watch you.
So
they
were not so much.
Yeah, so they're playing in Switzerland, they were playing in Norway,
right.
And Delia Inuba and Vincent were playing in Israel, which it was very difficult to get Israel league,
you know.
So, yeah, so when they come to the national team, so it was a little bit easier for us to exchange idea what they are doing, because they are more advanced, because they are already there. We are still on home base players, but we have the opportunity to go to the national team. So there you learn one or two things from there. They give you, they normally, their coaches give them like a program.
Yes.
They come back holiday. This is what you need to do. This is what you do. And they
record would share it. That information.
So they would share
with
that
you
information,
guys.
You know. Okay. So where I was fortunate to meet them, it was the national team. Mm. So I keep those information, take it to my club side and try to do that, you know, and try. So during that time, some of the clubs now start, you know, in getting goalkeeper coach.
Okay.
But not, they're not the ones that go for the courses, because normally you have to go to courses and you know how to train a goalkeeper. It's not the way you train
an outfield player.
So now you need to manage it. And, you know, basically before we run with the outfield player, we do everything they do.
Mm.
So it's during the game, now you get someone that warm me up. So after that time, now I started learning a lot of things. And even before I came to South Africa, I have to learn more things.
Mm.
But when I came to South Africa, that's where I become more exposed to goalkeeping.
So I guess it's fair to say that, like, a footballer's career is always about learning.
Yeah.
And that, you know, you never know enough.
Yeah.
Each and every season, opportunity to learn even more.
Yeah.
So, I mean, in terms of that, what are some of the things that you had to learn very, very quickly? Especially working with someone like Gavin. I can imagine he's a very demanding coach.
Yeah.
What were some of the things that you had to improve about your game to be his main guy?
Yeah, because, you know, coming to South Africa, it was very difficult. Mm. Because I went for trials in France. You know, Rising Club, the Lens, you know, I was there for 1 month. It was me, Rabiu Beta, Bartolomeo Beche, later signed for PSG, one of the, you know, bright stars that came out from Nigeria at that time. So I came to South Africa, which, you know, a lot of things I knew back in Nigeria, I need to change it. It wasn't the the goalkeeping package,
right,
the Gavin, you know, really won because it's demanding. First of all, you need to be strong mentally to play under Gavin,
right,
because there's going to be a lot of communication, a lot of talking, a lot of shouting. So you need to know when, okay, he's serious about that, or when you need, he needs you to improve.
Right.
So, but the first thing I learned when I came to South Africa is for crosses. You know, you need, how you need to come out for crosses. Because a lot of teams that time, the likes of Santos, likes of Manny Rangers, you know, and Super Sport, they, when you go play there in Cape Town, it's windy, you know, you need to come out across a lot of long balls. So,
long balls not something you had to worry about as much in Nigeria?
In Nigeria, you know, because everyone feel the Barcelona,
so
or they
want to
play, they play to feet, get, you know, the physicalness, you know, get their shoot. So your job basically as a goalkeeper is for the striker to shoot, because, you know, back home there in Nigeria, and mostly generally in West Africa, you have physical players that they're big, and if you're not big as a striker, they feel like, you know, you can't play.
Right.
So you get the ball, you hit a shot like a rocket. You go, if a goalkeeper can save it, they say this one is a good goalkeeper.
Okay.
So when I came to South Africa, there's now there's a little bit of technique, how, you know, you start from the back, you need to play with your feet, you need to come out for crosses, you need to start the attack as a goalkeeper. You basically, you're important in the team, because if you don't have a good goalkeeper, I mean, there's no team. Gavin, he pride himself with a good goalkeeper. He say he prefer not to have a good striker, but if I have a good goalkeeper and a good backline, he's gonna win something, because
you can build from that.
You can build from that. Yeah,
that makes sense. Now, obviously, for the most part, you are what many will consider a one club man. You know, with your long history, with what is now Swallows FC and what was then Moroka Swallows.
Yeah.
That journey, and, you know, kind of settling in and finding a home there. What was it about, you know, Swallows? Because obviously, you know, when we look at the history of the club, there were, you know, ups and downs, but there were sustained periods of the downs. But, you know, some players, you included, were very loyal, played for the badge and stuck around for the team. What over the years when you were there at Swallows made you feel like this is my home?
There's a lot of things. Yeah, there's a lot of things. You know, when I left Nigeria, I came to South Africa. One thing I wanted to do, I wanted to maintain my position in the national team.
Right.
And during that time, if you're not playing, you know, in terms of the bigger league, you know, you're not going to be called by in the national team. National team, like a pride for you as a player, you know, when you go to national team, you know, Nigeria is about 200 million people.
Right.
And if you are choosing among the 30 players or among the 22 players, you feel like, okay, you are doing something right. So moving away back home, the coaches were seeing me a lot, the likes of Stephen Keshi, late Stephen Keshi.
Right.
They were the home-based coaches, Austin Aguavon, you know, so they see you more often when you play back home, and you feel you have more chances as a home base when you do well, or most especially when your club side is winning the league or close to win the league.
Right.
They feel like you. But when you go outside and you're not playing or you're not doing well, your chances become limited.
Yes.
So, yeah. So when I came to Swallows, I feel like, okay, I need to do something. Because there were a lot of history. When I came, they say, okay, they were struggling. So when Gavin was leaving Black Leopard to come to Swallows, one point he made, he said, okay, we have to try to be in the top eight. Because during those time, top eight was a big priority.
Right,
you know, when you're in top eight, you feel like, okay, you are something.
You're
progressing. Yeah. So my first, assigned 2002, I came, Gavin said, okay, you want to see me? I came in June. I flew in on Sunday. I have to train because it was overnight a flight. You know, in the morning I arrive, I have to train 9 o'clock because Gavin's early man coach. You know, he said 9 o'clock, I must come. You want to see me?
Yeah.
I came, small-sided game. I trained. Then I went to the office the next day. They say I must go to the office the next day. I need to sign. So during that time, because you have to go back to make your work permit, because you couldn't make your work permit immediately. So you have to go back. So I signed the Tuesday. I traveled back because it was SAA. The flight during that time was SAA. The only flight, they flew to Nigeria every two times a week.
Okay.
So I need to go that Wednesday, otherwise I have to go on Sunday.
Right.
So they said I need to fly back so I can do my papers work. It was Leon Prince and Gavin Benstein, the director at that time, you know. So, yeah. So I signed, I went back to Nigeria. So they called me, they played up there. So that time there was a telecom charity and other tournaments.
Okay,
so they were playing the next week because normally it's supposed to take me a month for me to get my papers to the embassy, because there was only one embassy that time, South African embassy, which was in Lagos. Not like now you have in Abuja, you have everywhere.
Places,
so you have to drive to Lagos or fly to Lagos, you know. So, but I wasn't having a lot of cash. So I have to drive overnight, you know, to get to Lagos, to go to the embassy. Yo, so they were playing a game on the weekend, so I think they lost 5-0. I got a call straight from Gavin, you know, that no, I need to go to the embassy. They have, you know, submitted every document. I just need to bring my police report and all the stuff they needed in the embassy. I need to fly the next week, you know. So, yeah, so that's how, you know, they make everything possible. I came, I start fighting, you know, because there was Wendell Robinson. He is now the goalkeeper coach of Sundance. I found him there. He was the number one.
Yeah.
So I was a youngster coming from Nigeria. All I knew was, you know, for me to do well. I didn't have friends. I didn't know the country in terms of where to go. I was just, you know, from training from my house to training ground. I work hard, and Gavin saw something in me and feel like, okay, no, I'm gonna give you a chance. So when they was playing, he was the number one. I was the understudy. So my first game was against Santos in Rand Stadium. You know, I kept a clean sheet. We won 2-0. It was Sebastian Bat, Mark Itia, Musa Otenu, so Andre Arensi.
Yeah.
So they were that Santos team, they just won. I think they won the league before that time, you know. So for 2002, so they were strong, you know, they were very strong. And Gavin was determined to win something.
Right.
So my first game was very good. After that game, Gavin said, no, you're a young man, we're willing to give you opportunity, but it's left for you to take it.
Yes.
So I told myself that, you know, this is all opportunity for me to go back to the national team and for me to stay longer in the country or to stay in the club.
Okay, well, let's talk about that in terms of like patience for goalkeepers, because, you know, obviously it comes up a lot now when players move to different clubs and, you know, they have to wait for their chance. And I find that obviously goalkeepers don't change as often as maybe as outfield players do. What is the mental struggle that one has to sit with there, and how do you, you know, deal with the fact that, listen, right now I might just be the guy who helps this guy warm up, but eventually my opportunity will come around?
It's very difficult, because that position is a critical position, and not every coach is temper with that position, because they always say now, recently they say is the spine of the team, you know. So a goalkeeper, a center back, a midfielder, a striker, but goalkeeping, a goalkeeper, he can win you, he can get you 15 points. Imagine you a goalkeeper can get you 15 points, him alone. So you need to get a good one. You need to get a good one. So whenever that one that is number one, a coach have chosen and is doing well, it's difficult to take him out.
For sure.
Because it's not like an infield, you say, okay, now let me try him here. You can't try that position, you cannot try. So if one is doing well, and the more older you get, the more they say you become better as a goalkeeper.
Yes.
So you as a number two, all you can do is for you to keep him, in check.
Yeah.
And the coaches and the goalkeeper coach, they're very important in this aspect. Because normally you have two goalkeepers and you have a younger one that's coming from the development just to be the third one.
Yes.
So, but the second choice, you don't give him that name to say he's a second choice.
Yes.
You always tell him that he's as good to play as a first choice.
Right.
But for now, he's not playing. Mm. So you need to manage it very well. Mm. And the way you speak, your managing skills must be good, because a goalkeeper can sense that, okay, he's not going to play for the whole season.
Mm.
But if you give him that love and tell him that, okay, you are my number one, give him that opportunity. When you are training, you put him on the possible side sometimes. But you know, he knows he's not going to play in the game. But let him feel at home.
Right.
So he's going to push the other goalkeeper to do better.
Okay. I mean, we speak about the positive reinforcement. Are there any coaches that you ever worked with that made you doubt your ability?
I think for me, when I was playing, I didn't ever look at the coach. I look out what I can produce, what I can do best.
Right.
And as a player or as a goalkeeper, you can see when you're not doing well.
Yeah.
You can feel it,
it's obvious,
you can see
it's
not me.
Yeah.
So for you to get better, it's for you to keep on training and for you to improve yourself. If you think you have arrived, or you think that, okay, no, I've given up, or I feel like he want to bring me down, I'm accepting it, that's when you become that thing he think of you.
Right.
But if you feel, okay, I'm not doing it for him, the club, first of all, I want to make my name,
right.
I want to earn more money, I want to get a new contract. Mm. You know, so I want to do more. I want to be better.
Yeah.
You know, so you don't look at him. But
so you're saying you never had a coach that made you feel?
For me, I played for one team for a very long time.
Right.
So every coach that came, I was the number one.
Okay.
So, but
okay.
And it's a disadvantage too, because you feel like there's no competition.
Right.
But not that goalkeepers are not coming, because during my time at Swallows, I spent 16 seasons there. There was goalkeepers from Serbia, from Norway, in South Africa, everywhere.
Yeah.
So, but I still remain, the number one.
Right.
I played under about different coaches, about seven different coaches.
Right.
So they saw something in me, which I feel I don't know what they saw in me, but I think for me is my hard working, keep doing well, because no coach will play someone that he doesn't trust.
Yes.
Because you're handsome or because I'm doing a favor.
Right.
You're not gonna do that,
right.
Because he wants to win too.
Yes.
So I feel I was doing something right. Maybe the things I learned when I came here in terms of the discipline, in terms of taking my job seriously, and make the team to win.
Yeah.
Because they say you are good as a last game.
Yes, exactly.
So if the team win and you're doing well, there's no need to change. So for you to keep your position is for you to make sure the team keep winning.
Right. Okay. That makes a lot of sense. So let's talk about some of your famous or favorite teammates in terms of, obviously you as the goalkeeper, the last line of defense, you'll have your defenders in front of you who are like your bouncers, your security. Who was the best center-back pairing that you played with?
I play a lot of good
centre-backs. Who did you trust the most? Who did you think that
I trust all of them. I trust...
Of course you didn't say that, Greg. Who do you trust the most? Who did you know that when they were in front of you, you might have an easy game? If not, it was because, they did everything they could do to stop
okay,
that
ball. So, okay, can you give me the chance? Let me just pay them. Can you, So I played, For the years I played at Swallows, there was a lot of centre-backs.
For
there
sure.
was right-back, left-back. There was Osep and George Hommel. Osep, the one from Namibia, was very good centre-back.
Right.
George Hommel, very good centre-back.
Right.
I have Warren Lewis and Gary McNabb. I have the back. You have Innocent Chukwuya. You have Peter Peterson. You have... a lot of good center backs, but if you force me to choose my pairing that center back, I go with George Hommel,
right,
and Gary McNabb.
Okay, that would be ideal.
The center backs
in front of you.
Yeah.
Okay, and then the most fearsome striker you faced, like where he's got a missile of a shot or something that you just want to avoid.
That was Collins.
In terms of
Cousin Basuma, that was during his heydays, he was he's a very, very, very good striker.
Yeah.
But you have a lot of strikers I play against and I play with, in terms of the likes of late Dennis Slaughter, Lungisani Ndlela, Mama Niang, Karen Jordan. You have Mark Batchelor, the one that passed away, I think there's a lot of good strikers. You have Peter Ndlovu. Mm-hmm. I play with him at Swallows, the elder brother of Adam Ndlovu.
Right.
Yeah, so, there's a lot of them, but that's the ones that I feel like, because they were with me, and not to take away from Nombete, which, he was something else,
sure,
he was something
sure.
else, on the field and off the field. You have the likes of... Sandile Ndlovu, the AK-47,
right,
So I was, fortunate to play with them, in at Swallows, So and playing against, Mbesuma was one of the good strikers I played against.
Right. Okay.
But fortunately, I later played with him,
okay,
so I didn't have
go.
That trouble again.
Yes, exactly. Okay, and then let's talk about obviously moving past, as a player. As a goalkeeper, a lot of the time the mistakes are highlighted quite a bit.
Yeah.
Just take us through in terms of mentally. Was there anything you did off the field? A lot of people and in sport nowadays, mental health is coming to the fore.
Yeah.
How did you look after yours?
Goalkeeping is a difficult position because that position it's a thankless job, they always say, because a striker can miss a chance and he score one, you become a hero, a midfielder, a defender can make one tackle, become a hero. But you as a goalkeeper, when you make, whenever you make a mistake, it's a goal.
Yes.
And you're going to make mistake.
Right.
There's no goalkeeper up to now, I haven't seen that, you know, a play season, maybe two season or three season or one season, and never make a mistake.
Mistake,
yeah,
so
they're definitely going to make a mistake. But how do you come with it? Me, I deal with it with my family, because my parents, my dad, my mom, I speak to them. I speak to my wife, my children. You know, I'm close friends. You know, you have some close friends that really tell you the truth.
Yes.
And, you know, just friends that tell you on your face that if you do something right, that, you know, and which are the good friends, because they want you to do well so that they can speak good about you.
Sure.
So when you do something like that, they're the one first to say, no, this is not right.
Okay, but on that point, who was the last person you gave advice to? Who was the last person you counseled? You don't have to give me a name. You can just tell me about a goalkeeper who might have had an issue and you put your arm over him and said, listen.
It was Danny Akpeyi.
Okay.
Yeah, Danny Akpeyi was the one, you know, I spoke to recently.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, he was the one I told him after the Champions League final. I told him, I say, yeah, you can do better. Yeah, you know you can do better because I know you can do better. You know, we all goalkeepers, we know we can do better. But nevertheless, what you have done before the finals has covered whatever happened in the final, but you're a good goalkeeper. It's one person I tell him straight in the face. And you know, when you have people that you know you can tell him, he need to take it well to improve. That situation might not happen again, but should in case it happen again, this is how you're gonna deal with it. So I told him, I say, my friend, you kept how many clean sheets? Six to seven clean sheets in the Champions League. Probably if they want to give a prize, you are the best goalkeeper in the Champions League. Champions League is not like the league. You know, you used to be the best of the best. And it just unfortunately the finals, everyone expects you guys to win it, and it never happened. Okay, you're playing against a better side, you know, but you can do better. That he was the last person I gave advice to.
Okay, I mean, on that note, what do you make of the situation at the club that he's at? Because obviously there's a legend in Itumeleng Khune. You've got Bruce Fuma. You've got Peterson's just come in now.
Yeah.
You've got, you know, what would your advice to Daniel be if he asks you, should I stay or should I go?
The only advice I can give him now is just prepare yourself every day. Just prepare yourself. Whenever you're given that opportunity, you have to take it.
Right.
Don't wait. Don't. Anyone that is playing, you support, because the way you expect them to support you,
when you get a chance,
that's where they're gonna support you. It to do it very well.
Right.
So I did to do it very well. That's why I feel, you know, he's coming back now to do very well.
Right.
But you know, you cannot judge any goalkeeper on one game. You know, you cannot judge on two games. Even though you make a mistake or without mistake, you need to be consistent. That's where your goalkeeping. That's where you can say this one is a good goalkeeper.
Right.
And with Uti Itu, he has done that for past long time
for sure.
at Chiefs. That's why everybody love him. So you cannot judge him on one season.
Mm-hmm.
Every goalkeeper is gonna pass through that stage.
Mm.
So I say to Daniel, I say, four of you are number ones.
Mm.
But once you are called upon to go to the goals, do your job.
Right. Simple as that.
Yeah.
Okay. And then on the note of South African goalkeeping as a standard in general, you know, because as football fans, we all have something to say about the refs, we'll have something to say about strikers and goalkeepers as well. What do you make of the level that we're currently at compared to rest of Africa, firstly, and maybe the rest of the world?
In South Africa, there's two things for me that I think it contributes to get a lot of good goalkeepers. I think the 16 teams is good in terms of money-wise to manage it and in terms of sports. But if you have maybe 20 or 18, now the other goalkeepers that in other teams, they can have opportunity to go to other teams. Now you can have that bigger pool. If you check the likes of, you know, the Egypt League and other league in Africa, Africa, you see they have maybe 20 teams or maybe 24.
Right.
So, but apart from that, the only person you have now in terms of the younger goalkeeper is the one from Aros, which is, I think, is 26.
Right.
He went to the Olympics, he never played.
Yeah.
And William was there as one of the overage,
right,
you know, which is good for the country. But, you know, it's Olympics. You either get a striker that can score five goals and you get someone, okay, if you can keep one away, you can win 5-4, I think that could have been better. And that boy did very well.
Mm.
You know, I think he could have gotten a chance in the Olympics for him to boost his confidence.
Right.
You have the AmaZulu goalkeeper, who is 32, if I'm not mistaken. Mm. And now this is the only time he has the opportunity to play for the national team. And he's doing well. Mm. But after 2-4 years, because you see the Nations Cup and the World Cup, it comes after, you know, 2 years,
yes.
4 years.
Yes.
After then, who is the next?
Yes.
So now I think, and most of the club in the country, you can't say they're selfish. They want the best, mm-hmm. but they get the best from other teams, mm. in terms of the goalkeepers, mm. and the goalkeepers are not playing.
Right.
So, and they're sitting on the bench. Mm. So, and now as a goalkeeper, if you don't play for one season, mm. you become rusty.
But for sure.
You're not going to be the same goalkeeper,
for
because
sure.
goalkeeper, game by game, make you better.
For sure.
You know, so you have Brandy Peterson.
Right.
Which I feel, you know, good decision. He's going to play, mm. but he's not going to play often. You have to wait for Uitu. You wait for Daniel, mm. you wait for maybe Bruce to make a mistake.
Right.
But he's not getting the opportunity.
Yes.
That's why I say, as a goalkeeper, you need to prepare yourself. When you get that opportunity, don't go out again. Because it's going to take longer for you to get that position.
To circle
back to you again.
Yeah,
yeah. So
sure.
I just feel like a lot of teams, Sundowns, they have a lot of good goalkeepers there that can play in any team to be number one. Mm. Kaizer Chiefs, one. Mm. Pirates... Yeah, you can say, you know, in terms of, you know, to the extent, mm. they can have a goalkeeper that can play in that team to be number one.
Right.
For there, you can produce a lot of goalkeepers in terms of the national team.
Okay. No, there we go. I mean, yeah, if we look at the history, not bad names. Andre Aronsa, Hans Funk, Brian Maloyi, you've got Rowan, you've got Senzo. And I mean, does Wayne Sanderlands fall into that category? I mean, is Wayne kind of going into the twilight years of his career?
I think so. And if you see the names you mentioned now, the RNC, you know, Ron Fernandez, you know, just they take that boot step to go overseas.
Right.
You know, I feel there's money in the country, mm-hmm. and a little of comfort. You mm-hmm. think that, okay, because the money is there,
yeah.
I'm at home,
my
I feel
families,
I don't
yeah,
I need
families,
to challenge,
yeah, exactly.
You know, so everybody's here. So I feel, like me, what I did, I just take that bold step. Mm. When I was young, I said, no, let me go and try myself outside the country and see how I go.
Mm.
If it works, it's fine. If it doesn't work, I go back.
Mm.
I think most of the goalkeepers now, each will have that opportunity to do that after the Confederations Cup, after the World Cup. I think that was the right time for him mm. to just move out.
Yeah.
Even it's the Norway League,
mm.
even it's the Belgian League,
mm.
go and test yourself one or two or three seasons and
right.
come back. If
yeah.
you need to come back, if it's need
you
for you to come back,
yeah.
you can come back.
Exactly.
You're always a legend. But I think the goalkeepers in the country now, in terms of the Williams, in terms of Itu, mm. because I don't think it's old. It's too old not to
there.
Travel, you know,
right.
understand? As far as you have the experience,
yes.
you can go there.
That's what they're getting in you in
yeah.
a goalkeeper's
yeah.
experience.
Yeah, you so you see, I feel South African goalkeepers need to try to do that.
Mm.
Because you see in the South African League, there's a lot of foreign goalkeepers that come,
mm.
you know, which is a good thing. It's a competition.
Yes.
If they're not good enough, the teams will not play them.
Yes.
But they are good enough, that's why they are playing. And
right.
if you see the so-called big teams, it's only the foreign keepers that are playing there.
Okay, there we go. Some interesting insights, folks, from the main man himself, Greg Etafia. Greg, thank you so much, man.
No,
it's been good to catch up with you. And then just to catch up, besides working with us and when we hang out on Front Runner, what else is keeping you busy? How are you taking all the learnings as a final thought that you've learned all these years? How are you now applying your experience post-football career?
Yeah, what I'm doing now, I'm helping at Highlands Park,
mm-hmm.
you know, they're still there because they sold the status to Galaxy, but
right.
they have the Municipal League. I'm helping the goalkeepers there, and I have a lot of goalkeepers in terms of, I can call it, I'm just waiting for my boss off mm-hmm. the camera to give me the name I can put in my academy.
Right.
I have about six goalkeepers I help at Dreamistin Ground there.
Okay.
You know, they come, they get some training.
Yeah.
You know, I did my badges in terms of my calf D license, CAF C license. I'm going for my B license now. I did goalkeeping course in terms of the SAFA one and in terms of the CAF one.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm mixing both, you know.
Yeah.
So I'm trying to, you know, give back to the community and stay long in Dreamistin there. I think that's my territory. I understand
yeah, yeah,
that side, you know. So yeah, that's basically what I'm doing now.
Okay, great.
Yeah.
Greg Etafia, thank you so much for joining us. We've been broadcasting here from the Sofeng. Ikasi, thank you so much to the management for hosting us. We're going to have a meal now, but I hope you've had a good time listening to Greg Etafia telling you where it started and where it's going, because it certainly hasn't ended. Myself, Kamzambata, and the team that made this possible, until we do another one of these profiles, shout.
Thanks.